the Dodd-Frank financial protections enacted after the 2008 financial crisis. But the big news, the president talking at the top of that event about the dramatic news he made today. The president of the United States abruptly canceling his plans for a nuclear summit with Kim Jong-un, the leader of North Korea. That summit was scheduled for June 12th in Singapore. The president today releasing a letter he sent to the North Korean dictator saying, sorry, sir, the summit is off. Let me read you just one piece of it here as we continue to watch the president at the White House. The president saying, I was very much looking forward to being there with you. Sadly, based on the tremendous anger and open hostility displayed in your most recent statement, I feel it is inappropriate at this time to have this long-planned meeting. Therefore, please let this letter serve to represent that the Singapore summit, for the good of both parties, but to the detriment of the world, will not take place. The stock market is down because of this announcement. The South Korean parliament, the emergency national security team, is up late in an emergency meeting tonight because of this. Let's go straight to the White House now to our correspondent, Jeff Selle. Jeff, the president says the summit is off, and yet, oddly there, he said in his remarks that while he was sad this was happening, it is possible still, depending on the North Korean reaction, it could be put back in place. Help me with that.
John, and that is key. The tone of the president, both in the letter that he wrote to Kim Jong-un and the words that we just heard him there, I think are very important in all of this. This is not the same rhetoric or volume that he was using months ago when he was calling Kim Jong-un a rocket man, and he was threatening that North Korea would see a fire and fury unlike the world has ever seen. So they are intentionally keeping the same open door policy, if you will. We heard the same thing from Secretary of State Mike Pompeo on Capitol Hill all morning long. So they are very much in the mind of keeping open the possibility of this meeting happening again. But at the same time, we heard the president there saying he has alerted Defense Secretary James Mattis, South Korea as well, putting North Korea on notice that the U.S. is not going to be softer or backing down on sanctions or military possibility. But John, what we're learning here today, what led up to this, indeed, over the last 36 hours or so, I am told that the U.S. became very worried about this. They essentially were not able to hear or get in contact with the people that they had been speaking with in the regime. They were not believing that North Korea was actually going to go through with this. They were worried that they essentially would be left standing at the altar. The worst case scenario, one official told me, was the president flying over to Singapore, essentially waiting there for Kim Jong-un, and to be essentially stood up. So the White House, over the last 24 hours or so, has been very worried about this. The president, we're told, made the decision earlier this morning himself. Yes, it was because of some of the threatening language with the vice president, but it was far more than that. I'm told substantively they were worried that North Korea was simply not ready to negotiate. The idea of having the meeting had been worked out, the time, setting in Singapore. But beyond that, the details of what would happen in the meeting simply hadn't worked out. So, John, we've seen the president so eager for this meeting to happen. Ever since he walked into that briefing room on March 8th, he wanted this to happen. He's been saying, he was so eager for it to happen. You have to wonder if they got a little bit ahead of themselves here, and this is an attempt to pull back before it was too late. John?
Excellent way to characterize where we stand right now. The uncertainty. Jeff Zeleny at the White House, thank you. With me here in studio to share the reporting and their insights, Julie Hirschfeld Davis of the New York Times, CNN's Jim Sciutto, Politico's Eliana Johnson, and CNN's Caitlin Collins. It is just a wow moment in the sense that both leaders wanted this. Mm-hmm. Kim Jong-un wanted to be in the room with the President of the United States. That in and of itself would have been history, would have been legitimacy for the regime. President Trump thought he could do what no past U.S. president could do, get North Korea to the bargaining table, and somehow get a deal to denuclearize, although the president got a little squishy about the standards in recent days. Jim Sciutto, I want to start with you. The White House is saying that this is Pyongyang's fault. Mm-hmm. That Pyongyang had a very belligerent statement yesterday, we'll read from it in a minute, criticizing the vice president, threatening nuclear war, and therefore you don't get a summit if you behave that way. But we also know there were people around this president, and certainly hawks in Congress, who were nervous about the president going into that room, thinking that he might cut a deal way below the acceptability bar.
Typically, you arrange the principal's meeting when you have many of these issues already worked out. You don't sit the presidents across from each other until you get there. And clearly, many of the most basic issues were not solved before the president made this announcement. And lo and behold, North Korea does not change, does not turn on a dime, nor do North Korea's core national security interests. It didn't suddenly discover that it doesn't need nuclear weapons for its own survival. That's basically the way it looks at its issue. And for the president to have raised expectations to the point to say, listen, I'm in charge here, I got it, we can sit down, I'm going to work this out, was a little unrealistic, let's say. And you're seeing the evidence of that now with the president and the administration realizing, listen, this is not the time for this summit. I think it's important to note that this is more than a Washington story, as the president said. It's an enormous setback for North Korea and for the world, because remember where we were in the weeks and months leading up to discussion of these talks. Fire and fury, real concern. We were reporting just a few weeks ago that this administration was closer to ordering military action than previous administrations. The prospect of war on the Korean Peninsula. We're not necessarily back there to that point today, because the president does leave the opening for talks going forward. But we've certainly taken a step back, and there are real consequences to this.
And real questions, which is why the South Korean National Security Team is meeting. It's past midnight, their meeting, because the question now is, North Korea has been behaving relatively in recent weeks. No missile tests, no nuclear tests, much reduction in the provocative words, except for yesterday. North Korea was saying this, to borrow their words, we can also make the U.S. taste an appalling tragedy it has neither experienced nor even imagined up to now. Before making such reckless, threatening remarks without knowing exactly who he is facing, Pence should have seriously considered the terrible consequences of his words. Whether the United States will meet us at a meeting room or encounter us nuclear showdown is entirely dependent upon the decision and behavior of the United States. Now that is the kind of North Korean in-your-face threatening belligerence that, if you followed this story, you've seen for the past 25 or 30 years, particularly the last 5 or 6 years under this younger leader. What happened?
Right. Well, I mean, this seems to have reverted back to what we've seen in the past, and it's been a real pattern between the United States and North Korea. Every time we get close to, and it's not been a lot of times, but, you know, when there is sort of movement toward a potential diplomatic scheme where they can work things out, North Korea flexes its muscles, the United States pulls back. And, you know, it's interesting, I don't think we're back to fire and fury, that's for sure, but in the president's open letter to Kim Jong-un, he does make this comment about how we have a massive and power nuclear arsenal, and I hope to God we never have to use it. So he is sort of, you know, basically making it clear that he's willing to go back there if that's where this is going to go, if that's how the North Koreans want to play this. But also what's fascinating from what we heard from the president this morning and from that letter is he has had supreme confidence, and I think North Korea has as well, in his own personal ability to cut this deal, to sit down at this table. And that is why they didn't do it the way past administrations have, where you work out a lot of these really big, important issues before the principals get to the table. And lo and behold, they found out that you actually do have to do that groundwork, that the dynamic is not going to change just because you have two
but
unusual
How
leaders.
Was he convinced of that is my big question, in the sense that, forgive me, but I do not believe that the North Koreans criticizing Vice President Mike Pence is enough to get Donald Trump to walk away for what he thinks is an opportunity to have a world-altering global stage.
So I don't think it was just because they referred to the vice president as a political dummy. We were told that right off the bat, that it was that threat of nuclear war at the end that was a lot more worrisome to this administration. But we have to look at how quickly all of this unfolded. It was on March the 8th when the president had accepted the invitation to meet. And there is a sense in the past few weeks inside the White House that they were oversold by the North Koreans, who were the ones who extended that invitation on the North Koreans' behalf to the president, saying that they wanted to meet. So there certainly was that sense from them. And we're also learning from officials that in recent weeks, you know, there's been two trips by Secretary of State Mike Pompeo there that he didn't think they were serious about denuclearizing, and they weren't focusing on the logistics, or they weren't focused on the policy or the issues here, but they were focusing on the logistics of a summit like this. So what it would look like. And it didn't seem to that they were that serious about denuclearizing. And then, of course, in recent days, we've had a flurry of statements from them that are very aggressive, talking about John Bolton, talking about the vice president, all of these statements, and a breakdown in communication between the two sides. So you can see how the White House was so cautiously optimistic in the last few days. We all know lately they've been saying privately, it's still going to happen, we're still preparing for it. But word of caution, it may not happen on June 12th, and now it's not happening.
And think of the pendulum in just the president's rhetoric, from Locked and Loaded and Fire of Fury, which Jim mentioned, which had a lot of people unease, and then a lot of people saying, well, maybe that was what got Kim Jong-un to the table, the threat of a more aggressive administration, to he's excellent, he treated the hostages who were released, the prisoners released, he was excellent about that, he's been honorable in the preparations for the summit. A lot of conservatives were aghast at that, to hear the president of the United States, any president of the United States, say excellent and honorable about a man who starves his own people, who tortures his own people who lobs missiles over Japan and the like. And today, the president saying a setback for North Korea, a setback for the world, spoken to the defense secretary, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, South Korea and Japan already on watch should North Korea try any, quote, foolish and reckless acts. So we're back in a different place today.
That's certainly true. I think what you had here with the non-responsiveness of the North Koreans as American officials began to make efforts to plan the summit was the president became aware of the prospect of this becoming a real embarrassment for him, as it has for, as negotiations with North Korea have become for previous administrations. This administration has said, we're going to be different. It's going to turn out differently. We're not making a bad deal like the Obama administration made with Iran. We're going to distinguish ourselves. And I think when Trump began to see that this could be an embarrassment, and I think that's when he decided to pull back, and that his aides were encouraging that. I think John Bolton, the National Security Advisor, Mike Pompeo, the Secretary of State, were telling him that it can't hurt to put a little more time and thought into talks before diving in.
And those two gentlemen in particular, Bolton and Pompeo, much more skeptical that North Korea is going to come to the table with genuine goodwill, genuine ability, the willingness to give things up. And so where are we in the sense that you can have a war of words and a test of wills, if you will, between two people with both have high stakes in the conversation, then maybe, as the president said, maybe get this back together. He even left open the possibility of getting it back together on the original schedule. Or are you in a place where after this period of potential, at least detente, that it collapses, and there's huge risks in that if everyone decides now they have to prove themselves again?
Something has to change if there's going to be a summit, right? Because, I mean, you talk about people inside the administration who are expressing skepticism. The Defense Department just released its own intelligence report, which reaffirmed that, in their view, North Korea's intention is its own survival. That's its focus. And tied to its own survival is its belief that it needs nuclear weapons, right? I mean, core interests don't suddenly change. So something's going to have to change on both sides, you know, a willingness to compromise, a willingness to give some ground, perhaps even, if you really want the summit, if you really want an agreement, perhaps even the Trump administration saying, well, denuclearization, in our view, is not a 100% cleansing of the slate in North Korea. Maybe there's something we can live with, which would be interesting in light of their view of the Iran nuclear deal.
Could this president, after everything he has said, could this administration do
if that? He wants a deal? Something's going to have to change on both sides, or suddenly North Korea is going to have to say, you know what, we don't need it for our nuclear weapons. We trust Mr. Trump. It's fine. It's all off the table. But, you know, does anybody see that happening? No one I've talked to.
All right, quick break. Then we come back to more in our breaking news. The Singapore summit is canceled. The South Korean national security team on alert. The president of the United States says, I needed to cancel it, but maybe, just maybe, we can bring it back. How did we get here? When we return.
I think I understand why it's been taking place. But they want to do what's right. I really believe Kim Jong-un wants to do what's right. So hopefully things will work out. Okay? Thank you all very much.
Just waiting to see if the president takes any more questions.
We have a wonderful, there's been a very good working relationship. It started with the hostages coming back home. The hostages came home. We didn't have to pay. We wouldn't have paid. But they came back home. They're now safely ensconced in their houses. And they're very happy and thrilled. And they never thought it was going to happen. So the dialogue was good until recently. And I think I understand why that happened.
Why was that?
And I won't say that. Someday I'll give it to you. You can write about it in a book. But I really believe we have a great opportunity. We'll see whether or not that opportunity is seized by North Korea. If it is, great for them and great for the world. If it isn't, it'll be just fine. Thank you all very much. Thank
you. All you, Mr. President, do you expect him to call you?
President of the United States lingering, thinking for a second about whether he wanted to answer that last question. Does he expect Kim Jong-un to call him? The president, though, there after a bill signing, taking a couple of questions again about the big news of the day, his decision to cancel, send a letter to Kim Jong-un saying, no, I will not go forward, sir, with the planned North Korean nuclear summit June 12th in Singapore. Striking again, you've just canceled the summit. You've just said that North Korea's belligerent rhetoric of recent days leaves you no choice but to cancel the summit. And then there, though, you're striking a much more optimistic tone. This is the art of the deal, president. Is he somehow trying to have a little sugary rhetoric now? I think he means well. I think he wants to cut a deal. This would be a great opportunity for them. Is that the president trying to lure him back in?
I mean, I certainly think he's open to the possibility. And if you read The Art of the Deal, you know, it's all about knowing when to walk away from the negotiating table. In his mind, I think there's still a chance. I don't know, though, if there's really a practical chance. And the problem with the decision to schedule the summit so quickly without any of the preparation is that now that you've canceled it, as Jim said earlier, now you have to have a really good reason to go back to the table. And they have to have certain assurances and certain things that they that will make them more confident that this won't just happen again. So if this is a negotiating tactic, they've actually raised the bar for themselves significantly.
But and just there,
this was the untraditional model, as Jim pointed out in the last segment, two presidents coming to the table to make the deal, as opposed to two presidents coming to a table to sign a deal that has already been largely cooked, maybe one or two last things you have to work out. In this sense, now, to your point, can the administration come back to the table unless they have pretty much a document, something from North Korea in writing saying, look, we're willing to come at least halfway, now let's negotiate the second half?
Well, that's the question now, and that was really the question before. What have they promised you? What are they? Have they said they're going to do? I mean, it was already risky before to go to this meeting and not walk away with anything. But you heard the president just there say the dialogue with North Korea was very good until recently, and someone asked him why he thought that was, and he said, I'm not going to say. But we did hear him just a few days ago in the Oval Office with the South Korean president say that he thinks that part of the reason things have changed in recent days is because Kim Jong-un met with President Xi and had been speaking with the Chinese. So it does seem as if the president thinks they have something to do with it, because in the Oval Office the other day, he said that specifically and said that after the two of them spoke, that Kim Jong-un and the North Koreans had a very different attitude after. So the president there seemed to be alluding to that as part of the reason for why the communication between the two of them has broken down.
And that has long been a key part of this intractable riddle.
It is.
In the sense that China does have some influence. There's a debate about how much influence over the North Korean regime. But one thing we do know, you talk about core interests don't change. China does not want Germany on its border. It does not want a reunified Korea on its border. And therefore, anything that might weaken the regime, even though it doesn't like nuclear weapons in Pyongyang. So it is a tough choice for President Xi.
And China wants to drive this bus, right? When this was a U.S. to North Korea dialogue, China did not like that. There's a reason why Kim Jong-un then went to Beijing. They're trying to reinsert themselves into the process. They want to be part of this agreement, help define this agreement. But it's interesting, here the president there, I really believe Kim Jong-un wants to do what's right. What is that conviction based on? It's certainly not based on history, based on the way he has led, based on the way North Korea has broken repeated nuclear agreements. It is not based on what his own intelligence community is telling him. I just said that in the previous segment. Right. The DOD, Department of Defense, says, in fact, North Korea believes nuclear weapons are essential to its survival. So is it based just on his gut feeling because of the art of the deal? It's certainly not based on the intelligence.
The evidence does, and nor does the evidence of before this period of calm, exponentially missile test increase over the father, exponentially nuclear testing and expansion of the program over the father. So you're right, the evidence doesn't get there. So I want you to listen to this, though. This is the president in an interview with Fox and Friends that was taped yesterday that aired this morning. What you're seeing today from the Tom Cottons, the Marco Rubios, the more conservative voices on Capitol Hill is, thank you, Mr. President. We 100% agree you should have canceled this, Mr. President. They're putting the blame on Pyongyang. We all know privately they were skeptical the president might go in and lower the bar from complete and verifiable denuclearization. Listen to the president suggest just such a thing.
You okay with a phase in of a denuclearization if the confidence measures are required?
We're going to see. I'd like to have it done immediately, but, physically, a phase-in may be a little bit necessary. It would have to be a rapid phase-in, but I'd like to see it done at one time.
Now, again, the president didn't give away the candy store there, but just the idea that, I'd like to see it done, physically a phase-in, that's what made John Bolton included, around the president, but especially on Capitol Hill, people just saying, wait a minute, this is why, to the point Jim and others have made the conversation, this stuff has to be written in boldface, in caps, and underlined beforehand when you have an unpredictable president.
Yeah, the reason that not only the president's advisors but his allies on Capitol Hill were nervous is that normally the way that these summits take place is that they're like plays where all of the lines are scripted and you have the two leaders get together and it's essentially a photo op where President Trump would read his lines and President Kim Jong-un would read his lines, but they're entirely scripted by aides beforehand in the meetings leading up to them. I'm sure your viewers have noticed that President Trump doesn't read from a script. And so that made people very, very nervous. He was going to go into this and his desire for a deal would lead him to wing it. And yet, certainly that had people incredibly nervous that he would go into the meeting and lower the bar due to his desire to come out with a big deal.
I need a little switch in the conversation here. The Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, is on Capitol Hill testifying. He was asked a question about the president's conflicts of interest. real or perceived. Listen.
Given that the president refuses to disclose his tax returns, how can you assure the American people that American foreign policy is free of his personal conflicts of interest?
Senator, I find that question bizarre.
You don't want to answer it then.
Senator,
I just want to describe it as bizarre.
Yes, I do. I think that's indicative of my answer, Senator.
Yeah.
I've been incredibly involved in this administration's foreign policy now for some 16 months, and I have seen literally no evidence of what you are
scurrilously suggesting. No,
it is an outrageous suggestion.
My friend,
Senator.
It is not scurrilously. This has been raised by a number of people
out there. Yes, sir, it has. You want me to tell you who those folks are and what their political interests
may
well be?
No, I know. It's fake news. Now, let me.
Remarkable exchange there. Senator Tom Udall, a Democrat, questioning the Secretary of State, who's pushing it back quite aggressively, calling it scurrilous, to the idea that because we don't know the president's taxes, and we do know the Trump Organization has international interests, but we don't know the details of them without having the president's taxes. Fair question from the Democratic senator there, or as the Secretary of State wants to push back, saying scurrilous.
Well, I mean, listen, his sanctimonious response there was shall we say, a little rich. I mean, it's at least a fair question. He's a president. Previous presidents have had Democratic and Republican parties have had very liberal disclosures, financial disclosures, their taxes, et cetera. Previous presidents have not had the global business interest that this president has. Why is that not a reasonable question to ask? And listen, yes, it's principally been coming from Democrats, but not exclusively Democrats. People from previous Republican administrations have made the same point.
And it comes a day after another issue we're going to get to in a moment or two, the president saying he wants full transparency about the Russia meddling investigation. So on the one hand, he wants full transparency about some things. We have limited to no transparency about other things, meaning his tax returns, which every president since Richard Nixon has put in the public domain, this president will not.
Right, and there is, in fact, no way to answer the question that Senator Udall posed, which is, how can you assure us that there aren't conflicts of interest without that transparency? So he is, you know, he's leaning hard on the outrage factor, but the fact is there's no answer to that question unless there's a public record of it, and there is no public record of it unless the president provides one.
And some will say, on a day like this, that's not the question to pose to the Secretary of State at a public hearing on a day like this. Others would say you get a very rare opportunity to question anybody from the Trump administration in a public setting, a Secretary of State, because of the global interest. Welcome to American Politics 2018. Up next for us, the guest list expands at the last minute for a big meeting at the Justice Department out this hour in Washington. Right now, intelligence officials and Justice Department officials potentially sharing highly classified documents about the Russia investigation with members of Congress. Also on hand, the president's chief of staff. Some big, late changes, important changes to the guest list. This initially was a Republicans-only meeting, but top Intelligence Committee Democrat Adam Schiff now attending. He's taking the minority leader Nancy Pelosi's invite. And after bipartisan complaints, there's also a second briefing later today. The issue? What the president calls a spy scandal, and what the former head of the FBI calls careful, normal, legal use of confidential sources. CNN's Laura Jarrett is at the Justice Department for us here in Washington. Laura, do we know exactly what information is going to be shared in this meeting right now?
Hey there, John. This has really been the big question all week. As you saw some Republicans previewing almost yesterday, their disappointment that they won't actually obtain any documents on this confidential source. But I think it's worth reminding our viewers that we were here last week. The Justice Department invited Chairman Nunes over for a briefing. He did not respond to that inquiry. This is, of course, all surrounds his subpoena for any and all documents surrounding this confidential FBI source that the Justice Department was worried would risk the person's life, would worry about a risk to, you know, foreign relationships. And so at this point, it's worth wondering what exactly has changed. Obviously, the president's involvement has created an atmosphere of intrigue surrounding this entire event. He has now labeled it Spygate, and we will see part two with another briefing on Capitol Hill at 2 p.m., John.
And it will be fascinating to see what, if anything, the lawmakers coming out of that meeting say, and if they do talk, whether there's, shall we say, on everything else, Russia, some bipartisan agreement or disagreement on what the facts are. Laura, appreciate it. Get back in touch if we learn about the meeting. The president says these documents in question will show what he calls, quote, very bad things happening to his campaign, including this. President says the FBI ordered a professor to surveil his campaign. In a pair of morning tweets, Trump again called the FBI source, quote, a spy.
The entire cabal of the deep state never thought that Donald Trump was going to win. They took out a quote, unquote, insurance policy to make sure he didn't win. And now they're trying to justify how they're going to stay out of jail.
All righty. Let's add Bloomberg's Sahil Kapoor to the conversation. Great thing to come in on, right there. Look, this is a controversial meeting, number one. The police don't call up the people they're investigating or the friends of the people they're investigating and say, come on in. We're going to share the evidence so far or tell you how we're getting our evidence so far. It just doesn't happen. So that the President of the United States puts enough pressure on the Justice Department that they feel compelled to do this is in and of itself extraordinary. The Justice Department has blinked or read the law or something, and now instead of having the first meeting being Republicans only, you do have Democrats in the room, which I assume means that what they say after has more credibility, or are we going to get into a partisan divide again?
It would have been more extraordinary if they had a briefing about this confidential informant without any Democrats present for that. And that's what's created a lot of tension on Capitol Hill, which is Democrats were saying, if you do that, even if you have a briefing after that, but if you talk about a confidential, highly classified information outside this mechanism of the Gang of Eight, which is the leaders of both parties in both chambers, and the Intel chairman and ranking members in both chambers, then it creates a precedent for weaponizing intelligence for political purposes, and that's precisely what they tried to avoid. The inclusion of Adam Schiff wards that off a little bit. Of course, there's going to be a debate. People will probably have different versions of events. Nunes and Schiff have been at each other's throats, I think, for a year now. I don't know that that's going to change, but we're going to see this narrative and this counter-narrative continue to play out.
And we may not know the full answer just yet, but some would say, why is the president chief of staff there? Why would somebody with daily routine access to the president be getting a briefing that he could then share with the president on how the FBI got some of the investigation, at least in the early stages of this counterintelligence investigation? Again, you don't tell Al Capone who the source is in the mob.
And the White House initially said no one from the White House was going to be at these meetings, and then John Kelly's on the list, and as of late last night, White House officials said that they didn't think that the list was right, that John Kelly wasn't going, and then John Kelly was telling White House officials this morning, yes, I'm going, and I'm going to both meetings. So you do see the disconnect there. But we do know that the president himself got involved in inviting the Democrats because he wanted them there so they couldn't accuse the White House of playing games here, because he thinks this overall story is that there is this conspiracy working against him of these law enforcement officials who are out to get the president. But what we cannot miss in all of this, all of these details of the meetings, is that on Sunday, the president directed the Department of Justice to do something. The Department of Justice saying about his campaign that there were spies in it, and they said okay, and they're doing it. The Department of Justice is taking orders from the president here, and that is stunning.
I mean, it is. I think that what the president wanted is not what he's getting. He wanted a special counsel investigation, an independent investigation, essentially, of the investigation. And I think Rod Rosenstein at the Justice Department tried really hard to not have to do that and did not want to get into a confrontation with the president over that sort of unprecedented move. So they kicked it over to the inspector general. But Caitlin's right. The fact that they are agreeing to share information about an ongoing investigation, not just with members of Congress who have oversight over the investigation, but with a representative of the White House, when the White House is an integral part of what they are looking at, or the president and his former campaign aides are, is actually extraordinary. And I do think that part of the decision to involve the Democrats was to guard against these accusations of, we are just making this all up. But I think there's also no question that the president's allies, his chief of staff, the president himself, will hear what they want to hear in this briefing. Democrats will take away what they take away, and like Zahil said, this will be a partisan back and forth, but no matter what happens.
Which raises the question then, what do the leaders say? What do the alleged adults say, in the sense that Paul Ryan, the Speaker of the House, is at the noon meeting right now? We're told he's going to the earlier meeting because he has a scheduling conflict later. I want you to listen here. Mano Raju trying to put the question to the Speaker of the House, third in line to the president, third highest elected after the president and vice president, Republican in the land, supposed to be of a co-equal branch of government. Do you believe any of this?
Is it appropriate for the president to float the notion that there may have been spies implanted in his campaign, and this could be the biggest political scandal in history, without having any evidence to support that notion?
Look, we know Russia meddled in our election. We know that there was an effort to get to the bottom of that, and we're going to find out how all that took place. A lot of this is classified, so I'm just going to leave it at that. We're going to have more briefings on just this today.
You honestly believe that there were spies?
I don't know the answer to that question.
Do we get the answer when he does know the answer to that question, or will he say, all that is classified, I just can't talk about it?
I don't think we quite know yet what these guys are going to say when they come out of the meeting. But I do think that we're sort of conflating two different things. The FBI does have a counterintelligence function by which they can look into whether or not there was Russian interference into President Trump's campaign. It's a separate thing for the FBI to investigate a presidential candidate. And so I think that in our conversations, we're conflating the two, one of which would be entirely appropriate, the other of which might not be appropriate.
Right. And if there is something that is inappropriate, aren't the Republicans better off to have Democrats in the room so that when they come out and say there was some evidence of something, or if there's something, if there was something done that is inappropriate, by all means, those people should be held accountable. And the president has every right to have a grievance if that's the case, if that's the case. But he should have the facts first. Should he not? Or is that just asking too much?
There's not evidence yet that that is the case. I think the president has put out a theory, and it's being talked about a lot. And he's also making some insinuations that muddy the waters. For instance, he said that James Clapper said there was a spy who was spying on an FBI informant who was spying on the Trump campaign. James Clapper said the opposite. He said there was a spy to spy on the Russians. If the Russians were trying to infiltrate a presidential campaign, would we not want to know about it? And should they reveal that to at risk of potentially blowing that source and not getting the intel that they, you know, that they want on it? So there's a lot of muddying the waters here. And the more I talk to strategists and candidates and operatives on the national level, on a state level, the more they say that voters aren't being moved by this because there's so much noise and they don't know what to make of it. People have moved to their corners, and it's not an issue.
But that's what the president does.
Exactly.
He loves to muddy the waters. Think of how many conspiracy theories he has spread. That President Obama wasn't born here, that President Barack Obama wiretapped him, that he had conversations or tapes of his conversations with James Comey, that Ted Cruz's dad helped assassinate JFK. He says all of these things all the time, stunning statements with no facts, evidence-free, and then later on says, "I didn't say that. I simply suggested it."
And by the end of it, enough voters have heard it and believe it because it's been
out
there.
Or he might say he's president and you're not. He said that once or twice before. Before we go to break, it was an amazing year, remarkable year, sad year, marked by violence, contentious presidential election, and escalating anti-war sentiment. That year, 1968, one of the most consequential years in American history. Don't miss a special two-night CNN original series event starting Sunday. More on now on today's biggest breaking news. President Trump pulling the plug on that summit that would have made history, calling it North Korea's fault. But some of the administration also blamed China. They think that after a meeting between President Xi and Kim Jong-un, something else changed. China playing a key role in a change of tone from North Korea. Let's check in with our international correspondent, Matt Rivers. He's in Beijing.
Well, John, no official reaction yet from China to this announcement that the summit has been canceled. But we do know as recently as 24 hours ago that China was saying publicly that they hoped that this summit would proceed smoothly. But it's interesting because President Trump had brought up several times that China might have something to do with North Korea changing its rhetoric over the past several weeks, becoming more hostile towards the United States. And we do know that China has been engaged in a diplomatic blitz with North Korea over the past several weeks. Kim Jong-un has come to visit China twice, and China has sought to make sure that its strategic interests were being represented at this summit. But the fact of the matter is no one really publicly knows outside of the two respective governments, at least as far as we can tell, exactly what Xi Jinping, the president of China, said to Kim Jong-un. There was a lot of speculation that maybe he told North Korea to be tougher on the United States, but no one has at least publicly confirmed that. And so from there, we need to look at what China wants out of this situation. On the one hand, they don't like the influence that the Americans have over this process, but on the other hand, they are publicly in favor of denuclearization and they do not want military action on the Korean Peninsula. And so the question then becomes, what does China do next? Do they encourage Kim Jong-un to go back to the negotiating table? And if they do, will Kim Jong-un actually listen? John?
Matt Rivers in Beijing, appreciate that. When we come back, President Trump talking about the new NFL policy about the national anthem and about immigration judges versus immigration security officials. How are the two things connected? It's a midterm election year. The president's playing to the base. Funding for the border wall, if lawmakers expect him to sign it. Listen, this is Fox News this morning.
You actually have four different bills. Unless it includes a wall, and I mean a wall, a real wall, and unless it includes very strong border security, there'll be no approvals for me because I have to either approve it or not. There are bills going through. I'm watching one or two of them. We'll see what happens. I think it's time to get the whole package. It's not such a big deal, Brent. It's time to get the whole package.
Can he get a whole package, the whole package? He's gotten very modest down payments of his wall funding because it's impossible to get the votes for the whole package. As we get closer to the election, can they find those votes?
He can get the money for his wall. I think Democrats have already acceded to that as part of a DACA deal. What he cannot get is cuts to legal immigration, which he wants, which have scuttled immigration negotiations and DACA deals, I think, for months now. He wants to eliminate the diversity visa lottery. He wants to cut what he calls chain migration, which is family sponsorships for siblings, adult parents, adult children. Democrats are not moving on that. What's happening now is a group of moderate Republicans in the House are teaming up with Democrats to subvert Paul Ryan and to push a vote on the House floor. They can do that through this discharge petition. My colleague Eric Wasson reports that there are conversations happening now between those moderate Republicans and the leadership, as well as the hardliners, to see if Republicans can agree on a deal. Whether they can, I highly doubt it, because you're not going to get the hardliners to agree on path to citizenship without a whole bunch of restrictionist measures that cannot pass the House.
That has been the quicksand of the last 10, 15 years. I want you to listen to more in this interview about the president's tone. About the president, we all know he campaigned on having a tough border. One of the things that bothers the president is when you come to the United States border and you show up at the border, you can see a judge and apply for asylum. The president says he wishes it were different.
We're the only country, essentially, that has judges. They want to hire thousands of judges.
Yeah.
Other countries have, it's called security people, people that stand there and say, you can't come in. We have thousands of judges, and they need thousands of more judges. The whole system is corrupt. It's horrible. Who ever heard of a system where you put people through trials? Where do these judges come from? You know, a judge is a very special person. How do you hire thousands of people to be a judge?
There's a competing view that what makes America great is that if you are being oppressed somewhere, yes, illegal immigration is wrong, and the president has every right to stand up and say we should be able to protect our borders. Let me start there. He has every right to say we should be able to protect our borders from illegal immigration. Of course we should, and of course he should make his case and try to get the money. But the idea that if you are being persecuted somewhere, what people would say makes America great is you can show up at the border and say, help. Well, and get to see a judge, not a security person with a gun who sends you away.
Right. And what the president is saying, is so objectionable here is called due process for that particular process. There is, and by the way, there are people, there are our security personnel at the border, and he's made sure now there are more of them because the National Guard is now backing up at the border at his orders. But there is a process when these people present themselves and say they have a credible fear of going back to their home countries. There is a process whereby, you know, they get processed and they register and they get a court date and they get to plead their case and they figure out whether or not they should be allowed to stay. What he really objects to and what he's pointing to is the fact that, and it is a fact, that a lot of these people, when they do get their, you know, appointment to go and have their case heard, they disappear into the interior and oftentimes do not return for that court date, and therefore, you know, that's another source of illegal immigration. And he has really tried to get at that problem. It's really difficult to get at that problem. And one of the issues with what Sahil was talking about earlier is he wants this legislation.